So it's a good morning and welcome. This morning's session, overview of business intelligence in Office and SharePoint 2013. Very pleased to be here to present this topic to you today. Brief introduction of myself, Peter Myers. I work, wear two hats actually, my own company and as a training company, BizData. I offer training in this space here in Australia. My background is, have worked in business for many years, got involved in IT by some mistake at some point, and discovered that this was a much interesting career projection. So I learned Excel, I learned Access, and then I developed SQL Server skills on top. That was many, many years ago. For at least the past 10 years, I've been working in the business intelligence space with SQL Server and Office and SharePoint. Based in Melbourne, I include contact details here. If you need to reach out to me, there's always after the session or out in the exhibition hall or contact details included here on the slide. This is an ambitious 75-minute session simply because there is a lot of material to cover. And the way that I like to cover, I think it's like a picture that tells 1,000 words. It's better to show a picture, or in this case, an animated picture in the form of a demonstration, rather than go through lots of theory about what you can do with Excel, Visio, and SharePoint. So there are some 11 demonstrations that I'll use to build up and to show you how you can manage business intelligence within Office and SharePoint. So we'll be covering Office 2013, that includes Excel and Visio, and then SharePoint 2013 with Excel services, Visio services, and Performance Point services. So this really raises why we're doing this. This is the topic of self-service business intelligence. I know as a business intelligence practitioner that I work on corporate projects, delivering data warehouses, data models, managed reports, but the flavor of the month anyway is being able to push back to the business itself, to those that understand their data best, that understand their requirements, and put back to them with the appropriate tools, education, and of course, permission to the data that they need. Let's empower them to the mutual benefit of the business and IT to produce solutions. So be aware that this can introduce a whole new problem. You can push back to the business, but are IT going to be comfortable doing this? Are they going to be confident that the solutions that are being produced are being backed up, that they're actually consistent, that they're actually being reviewed and approved for use and consumption within the business? There's an entire topic we could have about governance of self-service BI. We don't go there in this session except to point out some key capabilities in products that will support IT, having more confidence in being able to monitor and supervise what is going on with the self-service creations within the business. Ultimately, we shouldn't overlook the fact that SSBI, self-service BI, is important, and it's likely to be a benefit for you when managed appropriately. Okay, Microsoft strategy and vision. I've been using this slide for over 10 years now. It's the same animation, but their strategy and vision have not changed. And that is that it's all about delivering insights to everyone that will help lead to better decision-making processes. Key to this is Microsoft Data Platform with SQL Server, the Collaboration Platform with SharePoint, and the Productivity Platform with Office, most notably Excel. So when we look at the investments that are being made by Microsoft from an end-user perspective, Excel is becoming a very rich BI tool. With every release, there is some new BI capability that will discover deeper insights in different ways based on your data. For the IT professional, when it comes to managing content, workflows, approval processes, SharePoint has been geared around supporting this in a self-service BI scenario. So let's start with Office 2013 playing a major role realizing Microsoft's BI vision. Are you aware that there are some estimated 1 billion installations of Office around the world today, of which the estimate is that there are 600 million active Excel applications being used? Probably not the right way to say it. 600 million people that would use Excel at least once a month. I think that's the statistic they come down to. So Microsoft have made strong investment in enriching Excel by enhancing its core spreadsheeting capabilities with the ability to go ahead and create business intelligence solutions via data modeling, reporting, even data mining, as I'll demonstrate to you today. Visio plays a role also, a smaller role, but I think it's a fun one, and I'll demonstrate that to you this morning. So here we see Excel. It is extended these days with add-ins. Power Pivot provides a rich interface to produce a workbook data model. Power Query, formerly known as Data Explorer, provides the ability to extract and transform data for consumption within a workbook. Power Map provides three-dimensional interactive spatial visualization. And finally, data mining with predictive analytics is incorporated through add-ins also in Excel. We'll see all of these today. So all up, Excel delivers a complete and powerful self-service BI tool. Let's face it, those that are likely to want to deliver answers from their data are probably already working with Excel today. So it's not terribly difficult to take that extra step to educate them, to promote awareness around the self-service capabilities, and encourage them to produce solutions using these newer technologies, typically more efficient and feature-rich approaches. So whether it's accessing data to connect to external data stores, cleansing data, there are a number of built-in capabilities with Excel, but there's also capabilities via Power Query. Also, in the data mining add-in, there's some data preparation tools. The ability to mash up and bring up data from multiple sources into one integrated model that we can report from, that'll lead nicely into my first demonstration. This can effectively be achieved with Power Pivot. Exploring and visualizing data can be achieved through a variety of different reporting options, be them pivot tables, pivot charts, my favorite, the cube functions, also Power View that has emerged as a new capability in Excel 2013. Finally, the sharing story is where SharePoint comes in. As a workbook, as a document, this document can be published to a SharePoint library whereby the request for that document will engage a server-side Excel calculation engine to refresh data and to return a result to the web browser in HTML. So it's a great way to then share the insights that have been created within the workbooks. It's all there in the slides. Let's start with what I think is the most impressive BI feature added to Excel, that is the concept of the data model. It's now referred to in Excel 2013 as the workbook model. It's part of the Excel product itself. With the add-in for Power Pivot, you get a very, very good and rich interface by which you can go ahead and configure the data model characteristics, the relationships, the calculations, and so on. The thing about these data models is that they can integrate from multiple and different data formats. They can represent extremely large volumes of data that could not be stored in an Excel workbook. So I'd like to put this question back to you. Does anyone know what the maximum number of rows within a worksheet of a workbook is supported today in Excel? 65,000, that was an answer that was maybe correct 5 or 6 years ago. 2 million, could we maybe half that? 1,048,576 to be precise. Take 2 to the power of 20 and you'll arrive at that number. So back in Excel 2007, I think when they enlarged the maximum rows that we could have in a workbook, that was considered to be a reasonable amount of data. But I can tell you with customers that I work with today that 1 million rows of data is not a lot of data. So the answer would be, do not load this data into the worksheet itself. You will load it into the workbook data model. And with the X velocity in-memory analytics engine, as it's technically known, the workbook model uses the analysis services tabular engine in the background, that when you load data into the model, it will read, encode, and compress to usually high degrees of compression, typically 1/10 the original size, but depending on your data, you may well find that the data reduces to 1% of the original size. And therefore, it is now potentially possible that you could have hundreds of millions of rows of data stored within the workbook, stored within the data model of the workbook, and then you could connect to this via Excel reports, pivot tables, pivot charts, and so on. So this topic deserves one or more dedicated sessions to really show off and talk about what Power Pivot could do. Let's use this for the first demonstration. It's like these cooking shows. I've already created the cake. I'm just going to put the layer of icing on top, all right? Time doesn't permit to create an entire workbook with a Power Pivot model, but this is a classic problem that Power Pivot has been designed to solve. And that is that the corporate systems, like the corporate data model, be it a cube, does not fully address the questions that we have. So the question we have here is not just what the sales are by date, state, or product, it's also what profit margins are we producing? And we look in the data warehouse and we don't define any information about cost. And that's where this first demonstration comes in. Let me start by showing you that with this Power Pivot data model in the workbook, I'll insert a pivot table. Based on the four tables in the workbook data model. And I'll introduce the sales. From my date table, I have a year, so I can filter down to, in this case, 2010. And then to provide context to this filtered value, I'll place the products hierarchy on the rows. And this way, I can drill down and see within the category the products and the sales that have been achieved. To provide interactive filtering, in this case by region, I'll add this as a slicer. And this will enable me then to say, well, OK, what happened within New England for 2010, right down to the product level? But as I've just mentioned, it does not help answer the questions that I have, like what profit margins? What are the profitable products and by how much? Now, it just so happens that I have information about the cost to produce the products, but it doesn't live within the corporate systems. It lives within a local workbook here on my desktop. So what I'm going to use is the Power Pivot window to go ahead and source from this Excel workbook my product cost workbook. So I'm creating a connection here to connect to and to interpret the data in this workbook. And if I preview the data, you'll see that for all of the 20 products that we have at Tailspin Toys, I have its stock keeping units, I have its name, I have the number of dollars it takes to produce that product. Now, for efficiency, I'm not going to introduce the product name itself. That's not required. It's already included in our data model. I just need the unique identifier and the cost. Click Finish. It's now loaded that data into the workbook data model. And here it exists as a new table. Drag and drop to produce a relationship between the corporate data and the local data. And then I'm going to switch across to my sales table. And I'm going to introduce some calculations. The first one here will be to navigate that relationship and to bring in the product cost and then multiply it by the quantity. So essentially, for each row within this table, I've been able to retrieve the product cost, multiply it by the quantity, and this effectively gives me a column that I'll rename to become COGS, the cost of goods sold. I can format this. Sure, there's slight bugs that happen now and then. If you're too fast for it, sometimes it hasn't finished one operation before you start the next. Now, as a column of data, for the analysis that we do, we typically want to aggregate the values in that column. And that's where this auto sum here allows me to create what we call calculated fields down the bottom here. This calculated field here is sum of COGS. I prefer to name it just cost. And it represents then the sum of everything within the column. Because of this, I can go ahead and hide this column. It's not required. It is this calculation that users will use in their reports. I can then produce new calculated fields like profit, which is really just the sales subtract the cost calculated field. And I'll format this as a currency. And then finally, to assess profitability. So we have some rules in the company. Profitability. I'm just going to make this equal to profit. Have this ability to create key performance indicators that support the monitoring of the actual profit against the expectation we have and to classify it by a status. Is it on track? Is it off track? Is it critically off track? By right-clicking this calculation, I can create a KPI. I can take the profit, divide it by the sales, providing that we're 5% more than 5% or less than 15%, we're off track but not critically. If we're 15% or above, we're on track. If we're less than 5%, we're critically off track. And let's use this status indicator. So what I've managed to do is to integrate the workbook data model with some local data. I've enhanced this table with additional calculations, including a key performance indicator. And one last optimization is just to hide this table, that business users should not know it even exists. Now, when I switch back to the Excel workbook, what we'll discover is that I now have cost, profit, and a KPI that lets me introduce value and status. And now we can understand that while Glider is slightly off track, it's really because one of the products is well and critically off track. And here's a classic solution with Power Pivot enabling the business user to take the corporate data and extend it with extra data and logic. That's completing a Power Pivot workbook. Next topic is Power Query. You may have come across this in preview, formerly known as Data Explorer. So here is a new add-in for Excel that will support extracting data from a variety of interesting sources, not your classic, not necessarily your classic relational sources, but Hadoop, Facebook, even web pages, as I'm about to demonstrate, can become sources of data. So let me just use the example here that my manager looks at this report and says, fantastic. That gives us the ability to analyze profit and even monitor the profitability of individual products across time and region. But what I'd really like to know then for region is the sales per capita. Where are our marketing efforts best resulting in sales? And that's a fantastic question, but again, we go to the data warehouse to discover that there's no population information available. And so what I would use is Power Query to source this data from some external store, in this case, a web page from some government census site. And then we could use Power Query to extract and to transform and prepare the data and then load it directly into the workbook data model. All right, so Power Query is still in preview. It's available for you to download presently and to try for yourself. It'll work with Office 2010 Service Pack 1 or Excel in 2013. Let's take a look then at sourcing and transforming some external data and then extending the Power Pivot model with additional data and logic. So I'm busy browsing across the web and I discover this web page. Resident population, July 2009. By state, it gives me population, it also gives me rank, it also tells me what the total for the United States was. Good enough. I copy this URL. I switch back to Excel, and then because the add-in has been installed, I can then go ahead and use the capability here to bring in data from a variety of places. And just to show you how rich this is, I'm going to keep it simple today. From the web, I will just paste in that URL. It goes off and retrieves the document and says, well, yes, there is an HTML table here that consists of state, number, and rank columns. So let me just double click here to rename my query to become state population. Instead of calling this number, I'm going to rename this to become census population. Rank is not required. Right click, remove. United States is not required. I just need what each state is doing. So I come in here and I just remove United States from the list. Now essentially what I've done, if you see her on the right-hand side, if I've introduced these four transformations to prepare the data being sourced from this HTML page. In fact, if I turn on the settings and show you the formula bar, there's an entire language, and what it's doing is building up incrementally the steps required to extract and prepare the data. So simply by clicking done, it adds a new sheet to the workbook and it loads the data in. And here it is, sheet one, which I'll rename state population. Now here in the query settings, I can continue to define or revise the query or click here to load that data directly into the data model. And now that it's been loaded, I'm going to go ahead and hide this sheet, switch across to the Power Pivot window, and there is the data that has been sourced and transformed from the web page. So in this case, what I'll do is create a relationship between state and state. I can then come to the state table, and I can add in a similar fashion a new column that will bring in the related value of population. So for each state, there's the population. To create a calculation that will aggregate it, I'll use the sum aggregate function, and I'll simply name this the population calculation. I can then go ahead and hide this column. Switching across to the sales table then, I can enrich this table with a new calculation named sales per capita, which will bring in the sales and divide it by my population calculation. I'll then express this as a currency.
Just for performance and also for that error where you have the if.
Mm-hmm. So there is a DAX function called divide, which would be a better use, so I'll agree. For simplicity in this session, I'm going to keep it straightforward. Thank you, Grant. All right, now switching back down to the Excel workbook, what we'll find automatically then is I have the ability to analyze by sales per capita. Classic example, this time using the power of Power Query to extract and source that data. Visualizations. Excel does a great job of this. So now that we've got our data, either externally sourced data or, in this case, the internal workbook model itself, a variety of options to visualize the data that you have, be it the classic pivot table or pivot chart, my favorite with the cube functions that work against the Power Pivot workbook model. There's PowerView, new in Excel 2013, Apps for Office, new in Office 2013, and PowerMap that we'll take a look at shortly for the three-dimensional geographic spatial analysis. So let's start with PowerView. In fact, I'd like to switch across to one more demo at this point, just to work with the cube functions. So here in a sheet that I've named Demographic Analysis, what I'm going to put in A1, when I commence to build a formula that commences with a cube formula, you'll see that there are seven functions. These have been available with Excel since 2007. The one of interest for me right here is to bring in a set of members. The IntelliSense here is very well done, so you can see that the first argument wants to know which connection, so this workbook data model is the connection to the PowerPivot data model. The next thing it wants to know is what set expression would be used to bring in the set. And so what I can do here is say, well, go to the product, and you'll find the product has demographic, it has an all member, and you can continue to use the IntelliSense to extract the members in the hierarchy. Or, if you know your MDX, which is the language that is being used here, multidimensional expressions is the language to use for business logic within a cube or for querying an analysis services data model. So here, I would say just bring in the children of the all member, and that would mean dynamically any children beneath the all member would be resolved by this expression. The caption is just a piece of text that will appear in cell A1. What is really in cell A1 is an object representing this set. So to build out a report then, I'll just put a header for my table. This is the demographic. And then I will use another cube function, this time the cube ranked member. Using the same connection, the set that it wants is found in A1. Simply by pressing F4, I convert that reference to an absolute reference, $A, $1. And then it wants to know which rank within the set. So rank number one is going to return the first member, which is the advanced demographic. Now, what I like doing is making these template formulas. If I change this to row of A1, the row function returns the row number for a given cell. Row of A1 is 1. Row of Z53 is 53. By using this formula, I can then copy this down, and it just works to give me the other members of the set. Here at A9, the fact that it couldn't find one is because we exceeded the boundaries of the set size. No problem, delete. Then here, I'll create a second column, which will be sales, and this time I'll use the cube value function. Using the same connection, using a measure, which is the sales. So these are all of the calculations that have been defined within the data model. And then I have as many filters as I want to pass in. In this case, if I pass in A4, this returns to me the cube value of 6.251 million, representing the advanced demographic sales. Now, where this demonstration will be heading later on is that I wanted to filter by the selection of the year made up here. So for cell C1, I'm going to provide a named range for it and call it year. And then I can extend the filter set of the cube value by saying pass in that named range. And now what we see is it's 3.587 million for year 2010 of advanced demographic sales. Then I simply copy that down to get the remaining values. Can't emphasize the usefulness of these functions. When you've got legacy reports, for example, that need to look the same as what they did, and now our data comes from a Power Pivot workbook data model, cell by cell, you can use these cube functions to extract members and to extract values from the data model. All right, to make this more like a report, I'm going to go ahead and format this as a header and make it a little more sexy. Selecting this range, I can now go ahead and add a chart based on that range. And this is some nice designs down here. Let's try this one here. And that's how I could visually express the sales by demographic for a given year. The other approach, and in Excel 2013, is PowerView. So PowerView first made available with reporting services integrated with SharePoint. It meant that you could produce these new experiences that were visually impressive based on a tabular model, and now available with CU4 for multidimensional models as well. The story I'm going to tell you is that in Excel 2013, this PowerView capability is available through new sheets in Excel 2013. They can connect to the workbook data model. They can also connect to external tabular models. The key points about this is that it's all user-friendly. This is an authoring tool that is projected at the business user directly based on a data model, and it's been built specifically to be sexy at all times. I mean, it says presentation ready up here, but really it's about sexiness with as few clicks as possible. So let me show you in demonstration how we can best show what the sales per capita looks like. So on the Insert tab, I have the ability to insert PowerView. By default, it's going to work off the workbook model. So we can see here on the right-hand side that I've got PowerView fields expressing all of the tables and resources that I have within the model. Let's rename this to become sales per capita. And also up here for the title. By introducing the year field from the date table, I end up with this table consisting of a single column and the distinct years found. I can increase the font size to make it a little more attractive. And because it's a single column table, I can switch it across to become a slicer that then provides this interactive filtering. So anything that I now do on this PowerView report is being filtered by the year 2010. By clicking in a blank area, I can commence designing a new visualization. In this case, it will be show me the state, and then from my sales table, show me the sales per capita. And now by clicking the column heading once to sort ascending, a second time to sort descending, we can see in descending order then what the states were that produced per capita sales in the year 2010. Now, it gets a little more impressive when we appreciate that we have a new capability in PowerView that allows us to convert this into a map. I need to enable the content to allow the communication to take place with the Bing Maps service. And then what we see is bubbles that represent each of the states, and the size is representing proportionally the sales per capita. I can configure this to make it a little more interesting by showing a breakdown by product demographic. So let's take demographic and express it here with color. And what that now means is that we can see, for example, what the novices were, what the professional were, and you can see the sales per capita by state. I think my manager's now happy. The requirements for profitability, the requirements for sales per capita have all been achieved here within Excel. Next, and new and available in Office 2013 are the apps for Office. I'm interested to know if anyone here in the audience has already had a play around with these. Okay, one or two of you. What I find is that most people don't know that they exist. These are solutions, as it says up here, that carry a light footprint. They use web standards, so HTML5, JavaScript, XML, REST API, and it's up to a web developer typically to encapsulate whatever they want to allow this to be embedded into the Excel worksheet itself. Some of the apps are free. In fact, the one that I'm about to demonstrate to you is such an example. The gauge that you see here on the slide itself is a freebie. It allows you to express through this animated pointer values against status ranges. I'm going to use one that's a little more quirky and fun, I think, and that is the bubbles. So back to my demographic analysis. This sales is a very standard way of expressing data through vertical bars. Let's try something different. So I go ahead and delete the chart. Maybe, if I could select it. That's it. No? You know what? Just delete all the columns that are in there. That's better. Okay, in order for bubbles to work, let's see. On the Insert tab, this is where you can insert apps for Office. Show me all the apps. These are the free apps that I've registered. Now, I could have paid for some as well. They would be here. But Bing Maps is another way of introducing maps into the workbook, and you can map ranges from the worksheet into it. And it will then geocode, look up locations, and plot values. Bubbles, I'll show you. Gauge, I've talked about. Simple about inserting it. What you'll find then is this little application that is now sitting inside my worksheet. Just resize this. All right. Now, what it's prompting us to do is to select a table. Why have I got two there? That's a sample table. No, I don't want you. Okay, now it's resized. Select a table. What it wants is an Excel table. So I select this range that really consists of cube functions. And then I just create this as a table that, yes, it has headers. And then I can click here and assign that table to the bubbles. And now we get to see through proportional size of the bubbles the different sales by demographic. So what's sort of cool with this, it's sort of animated. You can use the down button to add more gravity or the up one to release the gravity. And you can sort of flick them around. And by clicking on them, you can see statistics if we had enough zoom space. So it's cute. I mean, how practical it is, I'm not quite sure, but what I think it demonstrates is the extensibility story now, the ability for you to reach out and to enrich Excel with, you know, third-party apps for Office, or you can even develop your own. So you can no longer have this argument that I don't like the way Excel does something. Well, if you don't, go ahead and customize it, and this is a very reasonably straightforward way to do it with someone with web development skills. Ouch. Okay, let me just make sure I save everything. Oh, no. Well, the power pivot window is still working. Ouch, indeed. Okay, I move on to the next demo, and fingers crossed, the demo gods are on my side today. Only ever happens when you're up on stage in front of an audience, let me tell you. Okay. The next topic then is Power Map, so formerly known as GeoFlow, still in preview and publicly available for you to explore today. This is about three-dimensional data visualization spatially and also the support for animation spatially, which is something that PowerView doesn't do at this stage anyway. It can capture screenshots and build cinematic guided video tours that you can then share locally. So by the way, there's no publication story for this. You would have to send the workbook to somebody that also had Power Map installed, and then they could watch the tours that you present. Bit of smoke and mirrors going on here, because I'm actually switching across to a different workbook. It's been optimized for working with Power Map. The add-in has been installed. What that means is I can come to the Insert tab, and I have this mapping capability here. So I can go ahead and launch Geoflow. Now, there is a power pivot data model in this workbook that's very, very similar to one that I've demonstrated to you here today. Now, here in this new window, and you must be connected to the internet for this, is that I have this ability to start looking at the world, and this is all three-dimensional. Go ahead and show me where the state of Maine is. Here it zooms right in for me with the themes. Perhaps I prefer this. I can also add map labels if that's appropriate. Now, what I'm going to do is create a tour that will be called US Sales. This is for the Talspin Toys Company. It consists of a collection of scenes, of which we have one added automatically, and this scene is about the northeast of the United States. So what I'm going to do is configure the scene by providing it a name, Northeast US. And then to configure the data that will be represented on top of the map. Now, it will require that your data model has some geographic data. In this case, simply by including the states of the United States, we can see here by configuring this as a state province, we can then map. And then I can start to introduce metrics like revenue. And you'll see the revenue there growing, representing each state. In fact, just to hover over one of these is going to show you that this is Maine producing $643,000 of sales. Now, to make this a little more interesting, and because our focus has been on demographic analysis, let me come to the product and place demographic in the category. And now you'll see that there's this column being built up. You can express this as a column, bubble, or heat map. And the categorization here could also be clustered. So let me cluster it so we can see individual bars for each demographic. If I come to the layer itself and configure it, layer one really should be called demographic. So you can now see that we've got this nice little legend up here. And I can also go ahead and add in text boxes. So this would be the Northeast demographic sales. And I might choose to put this label up here. And maybe spell it right. There's my first scene, but I'm telling a story here. So I'm going to increase the tour with an additional scene. And this scene I will configure to be called the West Coast sales. And then I'll just use my mouse. This might have been a little more successful than what we saw in the keynote yesterday, as I understand. And let's just focus this on the West Coast. I can then go ahead and edit this and call this the West Coast Demographic Sales. Maybe move this down into this area under here. And we've got these great effects, so let me do a flyover, and you'll see what this effect does when we actually play the tour. Now then, to focus the story on what's going on with demographic sales over time, I'll add a third scene. And this scene, I'll go ahead and name the revenue growth by demographic. Demon. Demographic. And revenue growth will be fine. Let's see the whole US at the same time. And perhaps these bars aren't so cool. So here for the layer, I'll go ahead and configure this to use the bubble. All right, so now what we see is a pie chart for each of the states. And I can play around with the configuration here. I can make these sizes, you know, smaller or bigger. Now this is where it really gets cool, because for the configuration of the layer, I'm going to use the date. So there's date values stored in the data model, and you'll see that it's assigned to the time property across here. It's also introduced a timeline, and it's going to allow us to then animate across time and visually see in three dimensions spatially what's going on with our revenue. One last scene. Let's just focus on California. So this would be the CA revenue by demographic. And I'll use the push-in effect. Okay, and I won't use time analysis for this. Oh, yes, I will. But focusing on just on California. And we can also annotate what's going on here. Annotate this and use fields. Go ahead and show me what the state is. And as a description, I'd be interested to know the date and the revenue. And dynamically, it's going to build up these annotations that will play for me. OK, I think I'm good. So at this point, a tour consisting of four scenes. Let's see how it comes together. So here I could be telling people about the Northwest demographic sales. It's fairly static, but after 6 seconds, I can then start to talk to you about what's going on in the West Coast. And there's the effect of the flyover. And then to talk about the demographics and the sales and how they're changing by state across time. Notice in the left-hand corner, we've got our time scale. And then to talk specifically about California. And here I can focus on one of them being the intermediate sales, I think. There we go. Over time, that's what was going on in California. So this is what this visualization is about. Three-dimensional, spatial, based on the workbook data model and the ability to build up a story with a collection of scenes within a tour. Are there any questions about a power map tour? Yes, one question here. So if you want to represent it, I think that's the question. What you would need is the workbook consisting of the data model, so its data source. You would need internet connectivity for it to be able to express the big map. Okay, so they would all need to be in place. You'd also need the add-in for power map if you were going to send this workbook to somebody else. Okay, one more question. User training, so how would you go about this? Well, the user training would come down to optimizing your data model to have the right data that could then be visualized. It'd be a matter of then of ensuring that they had the add-in installed, and basically it's just a matter of going through each of the capabilities. So how do you configure a tour? How do you configure a scene? How do you configure the layers that are used to represent the data on the scene? It's a little bit convoluted at first, but once you get to it, it's just variation on a theme. So I would suggest that within an hour's training, if not less. It's all about experimentation, by the way. What does this do? Push it and find out. Users are typically pretty good at that. So if the data model is in the right shape and format, it's just a matter of experimentation. And if they know what they can achieve, if they can't find it immediately, they can experiment until they do. Okay. That was producing a PowerView map. Still on the topic of Excel, and we can talk about the data mining add-ins. These have been around since Excel 2007. These have been produced by the data mining team of analysis services, and this is a way of extending the reach of even data mining, considered to be an advanced analytic approach, essentially looking for patterns in data and exploiting those patterns for discovery purpose or for prediction purpose. There are, in fact, two add-ins available for Excel. There is the simplified one called the table analysis tools, that if you have data consisting inside an Excel table, the table analysis tools will come up and allow you to data mine it. What's interesting is the words data mining never appear in this add-in. They're things like forecast, basket analysis for association analysis. So it really abstracts a business user from getting concerned about what the underlying technology is. But what will happen is that when they configure through a very simplistic interface, that under the covers, the add-in will communicate with analysis services in multidimensional mode. It will actually send across a script to create a session mining model. It will send the data across to the server. It will mine it on the server. It will then bring back results that are expressed through Excel. The second add-in is the client tools that provides almost the full capability of the data mining product through Excel. So from data cleanliness, preparation, through to modeling, through to testing of accuracy, through to querying, and bringing query results of data mining models back into the workbook. So it's not for your light-hearted self-service BI person, but nonetheless, it's good to know. It's available as a free download, available since Excel 2007. Did we cross our fingers adequately? So it looks like Excel has had a bit of an attack. So we say goodbye to Excel, and for this reason, I have solution files. Don't look, as I just undo one thing. So what I have to do is forecast what I think the future sales are going to be, broken down by demographic. And so, very conveniently, I have data already available to me. Almost, hold on. Through a view. So there is sometimes the need for this self-service BI user to knock on the door of the IT department and say, look, what I need isn't available or it's not in the format that I need it. So in this case, the IT department took pity on the business user and they went ahead and they said, look, we've created a view. All you need to do in Excel is to connect to this instance of SQL Server. We have granted privileges for you to query a view that will give you the data that you need. So connecting to the local host and to the Tailspin Toys data warehouse, this is the view that they've created. And essentially what it's doing, it allows me to introduce a table consisting of a time index. These are the last 12 months of 2010. And here we see five columns expressing the sales achieved by month for each of the demographics. Now, this is an Excel table, and as a result of the add-in being installed, you'll see that you have all of these table tools available to us. Now, before I can go ahead and use them, I must establish a connection to the analysis services instance on the network. So here, I've been told that there is this database called DM Add-ins. And this is a database that has been configured to support permissions for me to create session mining models, which is what the add-in will be doing under the covers. So by clicking OK, that connection has now been established. With the table in focus, I can then say forecast, and I wanted to forecast the next 2 months. What's the timestamp? Well, you'll find the time index column is the timestamp representing each month, and the periodicity is what's the granularity of this data. It's monthly. This is a very important configuration because it's looking for patterns within years and so on. You don't even find the words data mining in this wizard experience. Then I click run. It connects to analysis services, sends off a script, sends off my data, mines it, and then it returns these additional two rows, representing, in this case, the first 2 months of 2011, and there's this an additional sheet showing me a chart, and there we can see with the dashed lines the projections based off the data. So, a classic example, and not a difficult one should you have data in a time series and you just want to forecast what it would be. This is going to be far better than a gut instinct that is guessing. This is supported through statistical and mature statistical techniques. That was the demo for working with table analysis tools. And that pretty much has covered most of what you can achieve with the various add-ins and features inside Excel 2013. I think there's a really cool story to tell with Visio as well. From a business intelligence perspective, we can bring diagrams to life by retrieving external data and relating that data to shapes in the diagram and expressing it in different ways, through text, through colors, through icons. And so the demonstration that I have for you here is that I'll be producing a data-driven diagram to show the statuses of the servers on our network. The diagram's already been created. Tailspin Toys servers, of which we have five. And what the self-service BI user has done, they've created a list in SharePoint whereby they maintain two columns, the server name, the unique name on the network, and the status, is it online or offline? It's a very, very simple example. So by switching across to the diagram then, the first thing I want to show you is that shapes in a diagram have properties. So you can see all of these properties that have been customized for this shape. And for the server name itself, it's been set to the unique name on the network. And if I select the second one, you'll see this is file 02, and here's our email server, and so on. So with that understanding, I'll then use the data tab to link data to shapes. You can bring in data from Excel, from a SharePoint list, from a SQL Server database, and others. By choosing the SharePoint, I connect to my site, and then I specify the server list that I have defined. By clicking Finish, it introduces a data set into the diagram, and we see this down here in the external data pane. By right-clicking inside, I can configure which columns I want to retrieve. So I'm only interested in the server and the status, so I deselect everything else. Yes, it would be good if there was a deselect all button. Which was that? Control A space? Don't know if I'll trust doing that in the middle of a demo. Do you reckon? Control A space? There's my external data, consisting of server and status. This will be refreshed, so if new servers are added in the future or status has changed, this will all reflect. Now, by dragging and dropping, you can create associations between the rows and the shapes, and look what happens here. It then extends the properties to include status. So that's a new property added to the shape. Now, rather than drag and drop individual rows, you can use the automatic link feature to say, for all shapes on this page, where the server matches the server. So the server column matches the value in the server property of the shape. Go ahead and establish a relationship. And now you'll see that icon here saying that each row is established. Now, to make it look good, up here we have data graphics. So let me go ahead and select all of these five. And then I'm going to create a new data graphic that will do two things. The first item that I add to the data graphic will express the server itself. That's the text name of the server. And I'll show this as text. Instead of using the default position, horizontally I want it to be centered, and vertically I want it positioned above the shape. There are built-in styles like heading 3 that I think is most attractive. And then the font size I can update to 16. Now, with that data graphic applied to all of those shapes, we now see that dynamically the value of that property is displayed as text above the shape. Next, I'll go ahead and I'll edit the data graphic by adding in a new item, this time for the status. And I'll express this through color by value. Now, the only value it has at the moment is online. And it says, well, that should be red. I think that's probably a bad idea. I think online is probably better reflected as green. But I can insert a new value knowing that it could potentially occur. And that would be the offline value that I'd set to red. And now that I apply this, you'll see that all of the shapes are green because that is the current status of all the servers. They're all online. And that's how we can produce this data-driven approach to our diagrams by connecting to external data, mapping them to these shapes, and then configuring the data graphics. There is a part two to this demonstration coming, how by we can share this through SharePoint and Visio services. That concludes the productivity suite with Office, namely with Excel 2013 and with Visio. We next move on to the collaboration platform with SharePoint. Designed to deliver content management, it's a great place to store your documents, knowing that they're being backed up, knowing that we have workflows like approval, that we have permissions maintained here. There's a whole business intelligence side that works on top of this content management system. There's a business intelligence center that kickstarts a site based on a template to support business intelligence activities. There are service applications like Excel services, Visio services, that provide server-side rendering of workbooks and diagrams. Performance Point Services is a service application designed around performance monitoring, and I'll finish with a demonstration of it today. And there are extensions with add-ins that support Power Pivot capabilities within SharePoint and also reporting services with Power View. So Excel services, essentially it is the calculation service that is not unlike the calculation service you have on the desktop. What it can do is load a workbook, recalculate it, refresh external data, and express this typically through HTML back to the browser. So think about this. You don't want people to download your workbook with the report. You want them to see it in the browser. This way they don't actually see your logic, your formulas, the underlying supporting data. And if there's a Power Pivot workbook data model in there, you're okay that that's not being downloaded and abused. All right, so this is a way of ensuring consistency, single version of the truth, and maintaining appropriate permissions. So here in the diagram, Excel workbooks are stored within the content databases. They are documents within libraries. The request for them will engage Excel services to load that workbook, refresh connections, recalculate the workbooks, and then via the web client to send back a response. Let's take a look at this in demonstration. So what I'll show you is working with Excel services. Back to my Excel workbook. So the need is to share the work that I've done with the profit monitoring here and with the demographic analysis with the bubbles. Okay. So unfortunately, this is the solution workbook, so let me show you what I would have done. By selecting the pivot table, here on the Analyze tab, I provide a friendly name for the pivot table. In this case, profit monitoring. For demographic analysis, I select this range and I name this range the demographic analysis. I also go to the View tab and I turn off the grid lines. My intention here is that when these get published, it doesn't even look like it's Excel. Next, before I publish this to SharePoint, I come to the browser view. And by default, what you'll see is that the entire workbook would be available for Excel services to render back to someone that has permission to load the workbook. What I do is switch it across to items, and I say just that pivot table named profit monitoring and the range that is called demographic analysis is available for analysis and reporting. There is the ability to parameterize, of which this has already been done. I have parameterized the year, which was the pivot table filter. So here's the rule. If it's a single cell named range that has a constant, not a formula behind it, you can parameterize it. This will allow the outside world to pass a value into the parameter. You can also parameterize slices, and you can parameterize the filters of pivot tables. And you'll see why, that when I assemble a dashboard integrating multiple parts, then I can use dashboard filters to pass into these parameters. So with that configured, I can now go ahead and save this, and I have the PowerPivot gallery. This is a library in SharePoint, and I save the workbook to here. We will return. So PowerPivot for SharePoint. There are in fact two add-ins. The PowerPivot add-in for Excel is about the business user and an experience about producing a data model within a workbook. The second add-in is within SharePoint, and it supports the deployment, the automatic refresh, and the monitoring by IT about the usage of not just the models themselves, but also the usage of server resources. What's going on with CPU? What's going on with memory? Are data refreshes failing? They can keep an eye on this. So here's a governance story coming in. It's all very well for users to create PowerPivot workbooks. If they're going to share them via SharePoint, IT will want to know about them. And this is what the PowerPivot add-in has been designed to do. With this, it enables the business user, once publishing the workbook, to configure automatic data refresh and to produce new analytic experiences based on the data model in the workbook. For example, I like the profit information here. I don't like the reports you've built. I want to create new reports by connecting to your PowerPivot workbook and then producing maybe some PowerView reports based off it on my client. So let's take a look at this in demo, exploring the PowerPivot for SharePoint. Now that I have published that workbook, I can now switch across to SharePoint and navigate to my PowerPivot gallery. And what you'll find here is that there are two reports available. By clicking on one, you see Excel Services is now loading and rendering that workbook. In fact, this is my bubbles report. So just to go and show you that these apps for Office will work in SharePoint as well, there is a single checkbox that an administrator must tick, which says it will allow apps for Office to be rendered. Okay, in which case SharePoint will need to go and retrieve the app for Office from its source, and it will cache it within the sites. Second report is the pivot table, and fully interactive here within the browser. The ability to expand, collapse, sort, and filter, and also modify the defined filters that are here. All happening server-side, and something else very interesting happened then. The first request that I have to manipulate the data beyond the data that was saved in the workbook. So by changing the filter from 2010 to 2009, what the Power Pivot System service did in SharePoint was it took the workbook data model and it restored it to analysis services inside the SharePoint farm. And then Excel Services is querying this. So essentially, this is a deployment story. Simply by publishing a workbook to SharePoint with the Power Pivot add-in enabled, the first use that Excel Services has to refresh that data will engage a deployment. Question? Okay, so the question is about what happens with external sources. Now, the data is cached in the data model, so it's not until such point in time that they're refreshed that it will matter how, in this case, the Power Pivot in SharePoint will attempt to connect to refresh the data in the model. So where I head to in this demo is to switch back to the gallery. You'll see here the ability to create new analytic experiences. So it'll open up Excel on the client, connect to the workbook, and allow you to produce a new pivot table, new cube functions, and so on. You can produce a PowerView report here in the browser, or to ensure that the data is maintained and kept current, we can manage the data refresh. By default, this is disabled. But should the user have permission for this document, they can come and enable it, and they can configure a scheduled frequency to refresh the entire model or selected connections within the model. So for example, this product cost, and I think this relates to your question, this is an Excel workbook with the connection saying, go to the D drive in this folder. That's not going to mean very much in SharePoint. All right, so if your intention was to refresh these types of resources, like an access database, for example, you would want to use a UNC, place it on a share, and ensure that appropriate permissions are in place, that the system service that will be connecting to it will have those rights. That's an in-depth level 300, 400 discussion you'll need to have, but it is possible for certain connection types. And that concludes the Power Pivot story, from creation through to deployment and through to maintaining currency through data refresh. I'm not ready to talk about Visio services yet. I've got one more demo. So where my demo went to was that we saw that we could use Excel services to render those two items independently. But my intention is to build a single experience through a dashboard whereby a user can control the filtering through a single filter and then see both visualizations at the same time. So what I'm going to do here is create in my dashboards library a new web part page. And essentially a web part page is a web page, look at the extension here, ASPX, it's ASP.net. I'm going to name this Sales Analysis. I'm going to use a layout template that will give me a header, a left column, and a body. And you can see the preview here on the left-hand side. So what this means is that your self-service BI user is also a web developer, but a web developer that doesn't need to know how to code web pages. By clicking Create, I've now extended the site with a new page. And here are the layout zones. So let's start by adding a web part into the body. In the business data category, there is the Excel web access. And I go ahead and add one of these web parts to the page. To configure it, I click on this link, and then I simply specify the workbook. In this case, from my Power Pivot gallery, I have sales analysis, and I insert. Because I have published individual items, and do you remember the name? I hope you do. You have to use the exact item name. I think it was profit monitoring, is the item that I want displayed in this part. Don't auto-generate a title bar. Don't give me a toolbar, although it might be relevant in some situations. The toolbar would let them work with functionality like download, document, refresh, and so on. And provide a better appearance with a title that is profit monitoring. Okay, so no code, but now I've embedded into a web page the pivot table. Let me repeat that one more time by adding another Excel web access web part, and this time configuring it for the second item. So this time it's demographic analysis, I think. Same configuration. And now side by side in the one page, I have both reports. So the last web part that I'm going to add then is a filter. So in the filters category, there are numerous different filter types, but the one of interest for me is the analysis services filter. And by adding this, I can connect to a data model and I can express a hierarchy to be exposed as a filter. So to configure it, I open up the tool pane, I provide a more friendly name, which would be the year. I will connect by using an ODC file. So an office data connection file have been pre-configured and saved by the IT group in support of the self-service BI activities. So here's an ODC file that connects to the sales analysis. It then interrogates the structure of the model and says, well, these are the dimensions you have. So in the date dimension, I then select the year hierarchy. It must be exactly the same hierarchy that your pivot table had configured. Under advanced options, I can specify a default, so you will need to know some MDX at this point if you want a default. So in the date dimension, in the year level, go and retrieve the member with a key of 2010. And finally, provide a more friendly name, year. And I'll make this 120 pixels wide. So by using that connection now, we'll express that hierarchy as a multi-select filter. So the last thing that I need to do then is to establish connections to connect the filter values and send them across to the other web parts in the web part page. So for demographic analysis, go ahead and get the values and pass them into, and there's the parameter that was exposed called year. Only one for this workbook. I can repeat that configuration to also create a connection to the second web part. Okay, notably all without code. So at this point, I can stop editing the page, and this is where someone like my manager can navigate to dashboards. Ah, sales analysis. To see this more fully, I will fill out the page. But there is the report consisting of cube functions, an app for office, a pivot table, and centrally filtered through one of the hierarchies in the data model, which will then refresh both. That will catch up at some point. No code. Achieved with Excel and Excel services and a web part page in SharePoint. Aha, there it is. Now, Visio services then is a similar story. That server-side rendering of a diagram and the refreshing of external data to keep the diagram up to date. And that's essentially the story that we have with Visio services. So let me show you by extension of the diagram that I've created and enhanced with the external data. What I'm going to do then is publish it to SharePoint and show you how it can be refreshed automatically to become an unattended dashboard. That should a server come offline, we're going to see that pop up at some stage. So in the Visio diagram, ready to publish, similar concept, there are publish options that can control what pages and data sources can be used by the service. I don't need to change these today. I'm simply going to go ahead and save this to the SharePoint library and to a library I've called Diagrams. You must save this as a VSDX. And having done so, that diagram is now published as a document to the library. A request for it will render that server-side. Let's take a look. Switch across to SharePoint and browse to my diagrams, and there it is. Now, in order for it to automatically refresh, I have to introduce it as a web part. So back to my dashboards, I'll create a second web part page. And here I'll call this server status, and I'll just use the full page vertical layout. Inside that layout, I'll add a single web part that will be from the business data and the Visio web access. Variation on a theme. Just go ahead and configure this by assigning a document to it. And there is the server status. This is the property of interest. Automatic refresh interval of zero says don't refresh. The minimum is 1 minute. So I'll configure this for one. And I might just change the appearance by making this bigger. So from a height point of view, 800 pixels. Fill up the screen. And now I stop editing this, and I'll go to the full screen layout. And there is my server status, maintained with live data. And to prove that, if I switch across to SharePoint and to my server list, how about I go ahead and modify the database server here? Because it's Oracle, it often goes offline. I've updated the status to offline, and with a little bit of patience and perhaps a couple of questions in the meantime, we should see this come through within at least a minute, if not sooner. Are there any questions? Yes. Is it modifying the drawing document? Not at all. So there's a question that actually comes up that is, can we dynamically change the diagram layout itself? Can we add new servers when they're introduced into the list? No. The diagram itself is static. The properties are static, but the values that are being passed in can be refreshed. Any other questions? I'm not moving on until that turns red. There we go. All right, database server is offline. Okay, again, all managed without any IT involvement, a diagram, the configuration of the data-driven design. The maintenance of the list and data itself is maintained outside of IT, and the publication of an unattended dashboard. All right, we arrive at the last topic, and this is a big topic as well. So a dedicated service application for performance management, consisting of KPIs, scorecards, dashboards. This is a reasonably advanced topic. I'm going to keep it simple today and talk about the fact that there are these seven elements consisting of data sources that could connect to your Power Pivot workbook in SharePoint to consume the data model data. It could be a corporate data model. We can then define key performance indicators that essentially bring together actual and target and then allow you to determine a status and to display this via indicators. And indicators determine icons, text colors, background colors that will be used to convey status. Are we on track? Are we off track? And essentially, KPIs then get reported through a scorecard that can also connect to data sources to allow dynamic filtering through hierarchies on the scorecard axes themselves. This delivers the monitoring capabilities to answer questions like, how are we going with profitability? How are we going with sales to expectation? Now, often what you'll find is where expectations are not being met, that's where you want reports to support analytics. Why are we not meeting expectation? And so together at a dashboard, we can then define filters and assemble scorecards and reports to provide a unified experience for performance management. Let me show you how this happens in 3 minutes or less. Good news is that I already have here in Dashboard Designer a workspace created. In fact, the connection that it's using is to the URL of the Power Pivot workbook that I'd published earlier. So here's a complete SSBI story, even producing dashboards through this product on top of the Power Pivot workbook. There's already a KPI in here. That was fast-tracking the demonstration. What I'm going to do is to produce a scorecard. And this scorecard will be a blank scorecard that will allow me to introduce that profitability KPI that I defined in the data model in the first demonstration. So if I click the update command here, you'll see real data being retrieved from the Power Pivot workbook via SharePoint. I'm going to introduce via the workbook dimensions that I bring in demographic as well. So let's take a look at profitability, and dynamically, I want to know what all the demographics are as well. So we then see the KPI being expressed via the different demographic classifications. I'll go ahead and format these as underline and use a blue color. So I think you'll appreciate that means some type of action could be launched from here. And then what I'll do is I'll just give this a better name like profit scorecard. And now I've defined a scorecard to report from the KPI. Now I already have a report here that shows me regional sales. So the last thing I need to do is configure the dashboard. And what you can see here is I have a header zone, left column, right column. Once deployed, this dashboard will create web part pages in SharePoint. We're just using a rich client application to define the web part page. So based on my resources, consisting of a year filter, which I'll place in the header, and my profit scorecard that I just created in the left column, and then my report for regional sales, I can introduce them and then define connections that the member unique name selected in the filter will be passed to the scorecard to filter it by a time period. The same connection of the member unique name will be passed to my report to filter it by the selected year. And then finally, because I put the demographics on the rows of the scorecard, I take its member unique name and I allow it to filter the report. Let's see the result of this. I save and deploy. And by deploy, it will create web part pages based on this definition. I'll choose a master page that is Seattle. And then you'll see here then in SharePoint that I have my filter with all the different years. Show me in 2010. Novice is off track. If I click it, note the way that novice gets passed across to filter and analyze what's going on. I'll choose to open this up in a new window so I have more real estate to go ahead and do things like drill through to the states of the region. Switch this across to a grid so I can now see in descending order what the state's contributions were. And then maybe I need additional measures because I'd like to know what the profit and the population of that state were. And then at this point, Kentucky is of interest. Let's use a decomposition tree to analyze this even further. Kentucky, tell me what you were at month level for that year. And within the months, tell me something about the kit types that were sold, and so on and so on. And this is the discovery process across your data in order to answer those questions, why are we not meeting expectations? And this is what this product has been designed to achieve. That's completing a performance point services dashboard. So in this rather ambitious session that has shown you from the productivity tools right through to the collaboration in SharePoint, this is what you can achieve today with Office 2013 and SharePoint 2013 to enable your business to help themselves and produce the solutions that they need. All right, all up, it's Excel, SharePoint, and SQL Server, and Visio has a minor role to play in there as well. As a next generation story that does come out of this is keep an eye on the topic of Power BI. This is the next evolution, a suite of tools consisting of Power Pivot, Power Query, Power Map, and some additionals. Keep an eye out for this because this is where this is heading and the direction that Microsoft are taking with it. On that note, I'll leave you with related content. This is really a plug for a session that I have tomorrow, which is SQL Server data mining. It's not a self-service BI topic, but it does link to the data mining discussion we had briefly with the add-ins in Excel. Beyond that, you can win a sculpt mouse. So we really do appreciate that you take the time and effort to complete the evaluations. They give us very valuable feedback on how best we're delivering to your needs at this conference. So please, take the time to complete the evaluation. You're in the running for a beautiful mouse. Beyond that, resources can be found at standard locations. I'll be in the exhibition hall for the remainder of the afternoon if you'd like to catch up with me in one of the demo booths. And I'll thank you for your time and attendance.